there is a danger, isn't there, in prosperity? Probably a danger that we've already seen the byproduct of, which brought us to the place where we were all so caught up in our own stuff that we let the foxes get into the hen house, the world in which we live. Those who are in leadership, they're giving us grief from the highest levels sometimes because we perhaps were a little bit blinded by the prosperity. You say, well, I'm not prosperous. Well, let me ask you this. Think about how this plays out. We've all seen it, haven't we? Kids come to you and they say, hey, Mom, hey, Dad, what do you want for Christmas? I don't need anything. I don't need anything. What? That's prosperity is what that is. And it's kind of interesting because I'm at the point in my life where I would appreciate just a $2, $3, $4, $5 gift, you know, that was really cool. Something big anymore. My father-in-law once got me a scraper for my windshield. This is just a really cool scraper. I can't find them anywhere. They don't make them anymore, and I have two of them, and I don't even use them. They're so cool. Isn't that stupid? But I don't park my car out in the snow anymore. So what is funny is that this thing, it had a brass, have you seen this? You're nodding, yeah. How many of you have seen them? They got a brass, like, fin on them. When you press that thing, it just goes like butter through the frost. You're none of this stuff. It was so cool. Now, probably at the time, he probably paid $2 to $5 for that thing. It was good. It worked. And maybe you found something like that. But what I'm saying is that, you know, it's not about the stuff anymore, is it? It's about family getting together. It's about having some time where you get to hug each other, laugh together, play together, you know, make memories together. The holidays change as we get older, and nevertheless, even at our younger ages, we have things that the world around us would be so envious of. And envy is certainly something that gets connected to the whole problem of prosperity. So we're going to look at this issue of the dangers of prosperity, for they seem to be very deliberately before us. And I want to just say at the outset that this is kind of the way we're going to go. I'm going to tell you now, because sometimes I don't always plug in the actual heading where it needs to be plugged in, but I'll do my best to do that for you today. But Israel was very prosperous at the time that Hosea was writing. Though there's a lot of doom and gloom in his message, he's warning them way ahead of time. He says the bridge is out. Guys, you need to straighten your gate. You need to turn around and begin to sow to righteousness. Because if you sow seeds of righteousness, you're going to reap righteousness. Okay? You're going to reap mercy and righteousness, all those things. But here, what we're going to see in these passages is that they didn't turn back. And he's going to tell them what they're going to have fully lost when the time comes. The first thing they're going to have lost is their worship. You're going to see that. They're going to have lost their worship. We've been seeing that in America a little bit, where our worship is being brought under attack, where the preachers can't preach and the people won't be able to have the truth given to them. The second thing they're going to lose is they're going to lose their witness. And the third thing they're going to lose is their wisdom. So that's your lay of the land. There is a passage in Proverbs 30, verse 8, that says this. It's 8 and 9. It says, remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me. Lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and take the name of my God in vain. You ought to have those verses written somewhere. That's a good verse as an adult to pass on to the youngers that are coming up. Because there's a sense that we have to have it all before we even get out of the gate. Well, there's a lot of joy I could tell you about in my backstory with Linda and me. We were watching TV once night when we were early in our marriage, and they said on there that poverty was this level. We laughed. We're in poverty. We're at poverty level. I don't know who wrote that. It's sort of like those weight charts. You know those weight charts? Don't you love those? Where'd they get those weight charts at anyway? If you're so high and so, you know, what many pounds, you're obese, you know. I think they went to Nigeria and found the runners. And they said, that's where we're going to base our plumb line on. So shaming goes on through those charts, I think, sometimes. But I'm not bitter. Anyway, let's move on. All right, let me tell you some things about this. All right. This first section is going to be from chapter 9, verses 1 down to about verse 10. And we're going to be talking about the fact that they're going to have lost their worship. The Lord comes to these people in Israel in a time of great prosperity. And he says, "Rejoice not, O Israel, for joy as other people." Now, the operative phrase here is "as other people." The Bible tells us that we are to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, right? We're supposed to be rejoicing. That's the kind of people we should be. But we don't need to be rejoicing as other people do. We need to be rejoicing in all the right things, not the wrong things. And the things that the people of Israel were rejoicing in was the fullness of their silos. I mean, they were rejoicing in the fact that their silos were full. He says in this passage, "For thou hast gone a whoring from thy God, thou hast loved a reward upon every corn floor." What he's saying is, you're loving the gift more than the giver. You've gotten to the place where the gift has eclipsed the giver. You have forgotten God. It has become for you not only an idol, because they went a whoring in a spiritual sense against God, but they got to the place where they actually thought that the false gods gave them this produce. Now, I want to warn us just a little bit. We have a new president with a little bit more of a familiar outlook on things for us. We're familiar. He wants to make America great again kind of thing. Those things are real nice. They're pithy. They make a nice little, statement and saying. But the reality is America is not going to be great because our silos are full. America will only be great when its churches are full. That's when it's great. That was said by some French guy who came over here trying to analyze this whole country when the earliest days of our country, when the Revolutionary War was going. They said the power of this people, the blessing of this people, the strength of this people was not found in their guns. It was not found in their arms of their flesh. It was found in their churches. These were a good people. And so we don't need to rejoice as other people do. We don't need to get caught up on a new job. Listen, God cares about the children. Do you know that? He does. He's going to provide for the children. If the job goes, God will find a way to meet the needs of those children if we're walking with Him. So it doesn't have anything to do with the economy for the believer. God is all, and He is all in all for us. And when we understand that, we're going to rejoice in Him. He's going to meet our needs. In fact, sometimes in your leanest time, you're the happiest. I remember my wife and I, when we first started out, we heard we were in poverty level. It was funny because we would write the check the day before the bill was made due. And that gave us 2 or 3 days back then to get lead time. And that was okay. Then they started changing those laws. And they get the mail there the next day. And they started saying, well, if it's not in by this time. So then we couldn't play that game anymore. But we just barely made it from check to check. And what was funny is we would make it a point to go out to once a week, nevertheless. And we didn't go out big. We went out and got a Frosty and split it, man. It cost $1. $1 for a Frosty. And it was a big one back then. And we would share that Frosty together. We were just, snug as bugs in a rug. And we just enjoyed the simple things. My point is that you don't have to have a lot to be happy. But you do have to have the Lord to be truly happy. And people get all caught up in the gift rather than the giver. And he says, don't rejoice like the other people. You've loved the reward upon every corn floor. He says, your floor and your wine press, therefore, shall not feed them. It's not going to feed you. He says, your new wine is going to fail. He says, because you put the stuff in front of the Savior, he says, I'm going to have to pull back the stuff. So we have to realize, just as happiness can never be the goal for the believer, we have to realize that wealth and prosperity can never be the goal of the individual either. You see, we understand holiness is the way to happiness. You see? And if we focus on the Savior, He will very, very likely begin to give us some stuff. Because the Bible says that godliness has promise of this life and that which is to come. So there is that promise. Do you know there are people who've taken the book of Proverbs and just began to live by it even though they don't know God? And if you'll live by the principles set forth in that particular book, very likely you're going to prosper. But the fact is that the blessing, the real blessing, is not in the stuff. It's in the Savior. It's in those things that we lay up ahead for ourselves. And he says, don't rejoice like the rest of the world, because if you've done that, you're not going to be able to enjoy that very much longer. You put stuff before me, and he says, therefore, I'm going to have to pull that back. Verse 3 says, they shall not dwell in the land, but Ephraim shall return to Egypt. And they shall eat unclean things in Assyria. Now, if you remember chapter 7 and verse 11, he says, Ephraim is like a silly dove without heart. They call to Egypt, they go to Assyria. So this is why he says that they will go to Egypt in chapter 9. Why? Not because they're going to physically go there. And the reason I have to qualify that is because if you keep reading, it's going to say they will not return to Egypt. But when it says they will go to Egypt, that's what they're going to do when they get into a corner. They're going to call to Egypt to come up and help them. Okay? So it's not going physically. He says they're not going to go there physically. In fact, the verse makes it clearer when he says they're going to eat strange things or unclean things in Assyria in verse 3. So I'm just trying to give you the lay of the land. The concept of their hearts. They're not going to turn to God when things get bad. They're going to turn to the way of the world. Now, because they've done that time and time again, it has become a pattern for them. And he says they're going to eat strange or unclean things in Assyria. In verse 3. Doesn't that remind you of Daniel? They get carried away into Babylonian captivity, which is another scenario for Judah. And when they were carried away, they tried to get them to eat the king's meat. And we won't defile ourselves with the king's meat. So you have that connection when they're put out of their land and lose their opportunity. Listen, to worship properly, they're going to end up defiling themselves further and further by eating unclean things in a foreign land. The Bible says in verse 5, what will you do in the solemn day and in the day of the feast of the Lord? The reason he brings that up is because what the first thing they're going to do is lose their worship. Because when they begin to worship stuff and prosperity and the gift rather than the giver, they're going to lose sight of church and the need for it. Think about that. Prosperity says, I don't need anything. I don't need to pray. I don't need to ask God for anything. I don't need to tithe. God didn't give me this, I got this. Doesn't he know that if he wasn't even in existence, I'd still be able to do that? No, it's not true. It is a falsehood. The reason we tithe is because we understand God's the giver of every good and perfect gift. And man, he's given me the strength to make the money. And I'm just going to honor him by giving back. It's funny because now at restaurants, they like to have a 20% tip, right? That's kind of a big thing these days. You got to give them a 20% tip. And yet do we tip God? I mean, it's his money. He says, all my tithes, you've robbed me. Why? You said, how have I robbed you? Well, in tithes, you haven't tithed. He says, you've robbed me, that's mine. He says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse and see if I won't pour you out a blessing. This is in Malachi chapter 3, if you want to look it up. And that's the concept. We think it's ours because we love and worship the gift rather than the giver. Do you realize how blessed we've been? This is the greatest country that's ever been on the face of the earth. It has been a country that was founded upon biblical principles, and yes, warts and all. There is no perfect person except Jesus. And there's no perfect country. Not America, not anywhere, okay? Not going to be a perfect place to live and dwell until King Jesus is here ruling with a rod of iron. It'll be a perfect government then. But what we have now is we have a more perfect union, we like to remind ourselves to. The framers used to say, we wanted to form a more perfect union. And we did. And you and I are just sitting large on top of a mountain of blessing. And here we are just watching the blessings pour in. And if things begin to change in the next few years, we're going to get back to our old selves again. And worship is going, well, it's going to be negotiable for us. I don't know that I need church, you know. Back in the days of the 50s and so forth, people went to church because it was socially acceptable. It helped their business to go along, you know, a little better because if everybody saw you at the church, that was good. It's not like that. There's no pomp and circumstance about going to church now. You go because you worship God. You don't go because you're going to get some pats on the back. You might get vilified today. People might frown upon you if you have a church relationship. You've heard about these HGTV couple that do the house fixing or something like that. I guess they've been targeted by LGBT. And the reality is they've been targeted. Why? Well, because they go to a church where they call homosexuality a sin. Now, funny thing is, they probably call a whole lot of other things sin too, but just because of that one, they've been targeted. My point is made. What will you do in the solemn day? Do you know that they don't know what to do now? If you're talking to a person who is of a Jewish background, or maybe you're having a conversation with them, I've been told that one of the things that's nice to ask them at one point, if you begin to get a relationship, is say, what do you do for your sacrifice? Because they have no altar, they have no temple, they have no place to offer, right? And this verse right here is foreshadowing that it would come to that. What are you going to do in the solemn day, in the day of the feast of the Lord? Where are you going to go? Because you've loved the gift rather than the giver, because you've turned your back on me, because you've gone like in the same way, in the same direction as all the other people in verse 1. And he says, for lo, they are gone, in verse 6. He says, they are gone because of destruction. Egypt shall gather them up. Memphis shall bury them. Now, Memphis is a city in, not Tennessee. Okay, so not Memphis, Tennessee. This is Memphis in Egypt. It was a capital city in the lower regions of Egypt, and it was a place that was known as a necropolis. A necropolis. You know, that has to do with a dead city. It's like a big, huge place where a lot of people were buried. He says, Memphis shall bury them. The pleasant places for thy silver, nettles shall possess them. Thorns shall be in their tabernacles. See, so he's saying what's going to happen is in Israel proper. Now, we're talking northern kingdom. Always keep that in mind in Hosea, because the northern kingdom had golden calf religion. And when they had priests devoted to the golden calf religion. It was all false religion. It was all false worship. And they would call the golden calves Jehovah, but it wasn't Jehovah. And so what he's saying is, he says, you've given it up, you've gone to your golden calf religion, you haven't gone back down to Jerusalem to worship. He says, you keep this up, you're going to have nowhere to go. Because if you keep not trafficking in the true, you're going to find that the true is taken out of play. And that's what happens. Do you know, I've been startled in recent days, and I've mentioned it before, but I've been startled to hear that in the UK, there are only 7% of people who say they even go to church in any kind of regularity. Now, that's people who say they go to church. That's not people who necessarily are going to a good church. They might be going to a church that's just church by name, but not have the gospel, because there's a lot of that. And so what has happened in the UK, which used to be really a huge place, I mean, you know, for Christendom, and it's just kind of found its way to this place where places of worship have had to shut down. We had a video one night, that's probably been about a year or so ago, about a woman who was over in the UK where Martin Luther at one time was said to have spoken, and they brought a Muslim imam in to pray. This woman is up in the balcony, and as she's looking down, she can't take it, and she just says, "The God of Martin Luther, the God of the Bible, rebuke you." And she's this, you know, spitfire of a lady. And they had to carry her out. But she says, "This is wrong. This is wrong. This is wrong." And it was wrong. But she was the only person in the room saying it. And my point is that when you begin to, you know, take the false, pretty soon, where are you going to go? Where are you going to go in the solemn day? And by the way, everybody's going to have one of those. Solemn days are going to come because that's the way of life. So let me go on. He says this. He says, the watchman of Ephraim was with my God. That's talking about prophets. You may remember that Ezekiel was told, "Son of man, I have made you a watchman. And you need to warn people that not if they turn, they will be forgiven, but if they don't, they will be judged in some way." Verse 8 says, the watchman was with my God, but the prophet is a snare. So now he's saying that in this northern kingdom, the prophets were prophesying that which was like a trap. When it says a snare, don't just think of a snare. Think of it as a trap, because that's what it is. When you look at the types of things you can find on your TV in the religious world, dangerous. There are a lot of traps set out there. You know, people are beginning to be drawn in by various perversions and twistings of true gospel doctrine. And so he says that was what these prophets were. These prophets were a snare. He says in verse 9, they have deeply corrupted themselves as in the days of Gibeah. Now, because the prophets had prophesied a trap, a message that was basically a trap, the people in the northern kingdom became so corrupted that they were just like that corruption that was there in Gibeah. Now, I know that's not something we can readily call to mind, but Gibeah, it was in Judges 19 where a man's concubine was abused and died on some steps, and he cut her up into 12 pieces and sent her throughout the entire region of Israel, saying, our country is out of control. He says, you've corrupted yourselves to the point that was there in Judges 19. He says, I found, verse 10, Israel like grapes in the wilderness. I saw your fathers as the first ripe in the fig tree at her first time. In other words, in the first fruits coming forth. He says, but they went to Baal Peor. And he said, separated themselves under that shame, and their abominations were according as they loved. Now, Baal Peor is one of the most heinous kind of worships. You can't even talk about it. I can't even tell you what it was. It was so nasty and bad. But my point is he says these people, because they had lost the plot, they were not going to have anywhere to go when the worship came around, when the feast came around, when they were having their solemn assemblies. They weren't going to have anywhere to go to worship. All of their blessings were going to have to be dissipated. God was going to bring it to the point where they could not offer, in verse 4, wine offerings and so forth. He says none of those things. He says the bread would be as the bread of mourners. And when they did bring something, they would hate doing it. It's like Isaiah 66, verse 3 says, he that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He's talking about the sacrifices. He says, it's gotten so bad that when you took your sacrifice to kill an ox, you mourned over that thing like you were killing a person. It's like PETA, right? People eating tasty animals. No, that's not what it stands for. PETA, people for the ethical treatment of animals. Yeah, I did go there. But PETA, you know, people are worshiping the animals, you know? There was a little chant some years ago when people were getting a little outraged about the whole abortion movement in our country. They'd say, you know, be a hero, save a whale, save a baby, go to jail. There were people who were vilified for sitting in front of abortion clinics and just saying, you know, listen, we're saying we're sorry. We're repenting. It's our fault. We're just having to sit in. And we're begging people, please don't abort your babies. And so they would go to jail. And what I'm saying is they would lose their worship. He said, you guys have worshipped your gifts and you've forgotten the giver. Doesn't that just kind of sound so familiar today? You know, don't witness to me. Don't talk to me about God. You know, I know I've got my electronics and my Google and my internet, and I can go answer questions and I can pick the thing that suits me. And our consciences are dumbed down, and our spirits are weak, and our minds are clamorous and cluttered, and we can hurt for a few moments, but click something on, and suddenly we're not hurting anymore because we've chased something else. You see, this is your kids, because most of us in this generation grew up in a time where we understand, when I say that, the distinction, because we remember the daylight. We remember getting together a sandlot game, if you will, down at the corner of the street. Kids don't do that today. What they do is they click, 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 click. And what's happened is that the parents have set that up for them. Because we became fascinated, they became fascinated. So they're going to lose their worship. What are you going to do? Where are you going to go worship? How are you going to even know where a good, you know, message is going to be brought? Because there's not going to be any that will be there to be had. Verse 11 takes us from the loss of their worship to the loss of their witness. You see, God didn't save us for nothing. And he didn't save Israel for nothing. He didn't pull Abraham out and say, I'm going to make a great nation of you for no reason. He did it so they would be the lighthouse in that dark world. The Bible says, as for Ephraim, their glory shall fly away. Verse 12 says, woe to them when I depart from them. You may recall in Ezekiel where it talks about the Shekinah glory being seated over the Ark of the Covenant inside the holiest of holies. And Ezekiel was shown that Shekinah glory moving from there to the gate of the holy place. So he's moved out of the Holy of Holies into the gate and at the door and then out to the gate of the tabernacle or temple at that time and then up into a mountain and then waiting and tarrying and then gone. You see, when God removes his blessing, the hedge is gone. Most people who have thought deeply about the things of our country in recent days believe that when 9/11 occurred, it was a deliberate wake-up call to America to realize that God has pulled back his hedge from our country. Because people had tried to do these things before, but America continued to fritter away the times and the opportunities, and the church specifically did. And subsequently, the hedge was taken from us. And because the hedge was taken, it wasn't taken just in that. That was the wake-up call. Okay, that was the SWAT that got our attention. The real place the hedge was broken down and being shown to be broken down was in the halls of Congress, where more and more ungodly people were filling in the seats. And the people who were being voted for by the population. Okay, we were voting them in. And subsequently, all those seats began to be occupied by people who were godless, had no scruples. You know, we talk about somebody being unscrupulous. They have no scruples. There's no guilt. There's no shame. And there's no conscience anymore. Well, it says, their glory shall fly away like a bird. It says in verse 12, woe also to them when I depart from them. Ephraim, as I saw Tyrus, is planted in a pleasant place. Do you think America's planted in a pleasant place? I think we are. We have a beautiful land. We had these Chinese students we took in, kind of exchange students, and they were just taken in. Man, it's like a garden everywhere. Because where they live, it's buildings. You know, everything's cramped into a small space and tall buildings and going to schools and everything is structured and, you know, even though they have a lot of landmass, everybody's kind of crammed into elbow-to-elbow kind of circumstances. For you and me, we have land that is bountiful and blessed and capable of sustaining us and so much. The oil reserves that are here in our own land, it is a pleasant place. We know this thing can turn around. We don't need to be dependent upon the rest of the world for our energy. And yet, because there are those who are unscrupulous, getting into positions of power, they begin to say, let's shut down this. You know, the drilling off of Florida. You guys may remember, we used to drill out there. And then President Obama said, no more drilling. No more drilling in the ocean. And then gave a pass to Venezuela to drill in the ocean and facilitated it by giving money. My point is unscrupulous. This is not a little thing. The hedge went down and the Congress filled up. It was already in trouble, but when the church began to be inundated with prosperity, I believe somehow we lost the plot. He says Ephraim is planted, in verse 13, in a pleasant place, but Ephraim shall bring forth his children to the murderer. When you see these things going on in the news today, the people getting stabbed and people being shot, OSU being hit. Last week, where the guy ran through and got out after he did, he ran over some people and started stabbing people. This stuff is crazy, right? And what's funny is that the narrative that comes back to us is, we don't know who the guy was at this point. We don't know. And by the time the story is old in your mind, you forgot that you were wondering, was it a terrorist attack? And they still won't use the proper terms. My point is, we've gotten our values so whacked that we can't even understand right from wrong anymore. The bull was to be taken in our place as an offering. That's what was going on. Yes, it hurt. Yes, it was ugly. Yes, it was bloody. Yes, it was terrible. It was awful. But praise God, God took that bullock rather than me. Rather than my child, he took a sacrifice. He took the offerings rather than our lives. Because the soul that sins, it must die. But God says it would take this. And eventually he would send his son as the Lamb of God. And he would die. And it would not be pretty. And it would be bloody. And it would be awful. And even to this day, the world of those who have no clue walked by the cross and spit on it as if it mattered not. But it was the most meaningful part of all history. In fact, if you can envision it in your mind, think of that cross as a wedge that split time. We call it AD and BC, right? He split time. He defines it because history is his story. Well, I suggest to you, he says something very profound here when he says that Ephraim is planted in a pleasant place. He says in verse 15, he says, all their wickedness is in Gilgal, for there I hated them. Now you have to understand who Gilgal was. In 1 Samuel, in chapter 11, and verses 14 and following, this is where the people said, give us a king. They said, give us a king. He says, that's where it all started. Their wickedness started in Gilgal. That's where they said, give me a king, and I hated them. Man, Samuel was devastated. He's just miserable. He says, listen, give them a king. God said, give them a king. They have not rejected you. They have rejected me. We can't look to the king. He says, if you look to the king, all of your wickedness will flow from that. Isn't that interesting to consider? If I let them take care of my health care and my money for food and all of those things, if I let that be how I define myself, and I go frittering and chasing butterflies and, you know, rejoicing in the prosperity rather than in the one who prospers us, you know, and gives us the ability. If I forget what's going on, he says, that's basically what's happening. You and I would be then going after another king. We want somebody else to reign over us. You know, God says how we need to live, right? He tells us that we need to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. That's what we need to do. And he would have us all have our own vine and our own land and our own joy and our own wife or our own husband and our own children and our own happiness and joy and blessing and drawing down on a creator who gives and gives and gives again. He's so good. But if I'm looking to a king to meet my need, I forget him and I lose my worship, but I also lose my witness. Ephraim. He says, your glory is going to fly away. Woe to you when I depart. He says, all your wickedness, verse 15, is in Gilgal. For there I hated them. Look at the end of verse 15. It says, all their princes are revolters. Can I say this? Our Congress is full of revolters. And this is why you and I, you know, have this static down here on the lower levels. But these things ought not so to be. God would not have it so. It wasn't so originally, but here we are today. The Bible says in verse 16, Ephraim is smitten, and they shall bear no fruit in verse 16. You may recall Mark 4. You put it over there in your margin, if you will. The soils, the parable of the soils. The Bible talks about some being on wayside. That gets carried away quickly, but summer's going to bear no fruit because it's going to be scorched because it was among thorns or it was among the stony ground, but they're going to bear no fruit. Verse 17 says, my God will cast them away. Who's he going to cast away? Israel. Does that mean he's done with them? Wait a minute. The verse doesn't stop there. There are those who teach today that God is done with Israel. May I say to you very clearly that if God is done with Israel, you have no reason to be thinking that maybe God might not be done with you after a while. You push the envelope too far. You see, the fact that God is not done with Israel is emblematic truth that we need to draw down on when we feel like, no, we don't know which way's up. Because God is good. God is a covenant-keeping God. God is the God of loving kindness and mercies that never end. They're new every morning. Isn't that good to know? Amen. And because it's true, we see that God's not done with Israel. Verse 17 says, my God will cast them away. Look at this. It says, they shall be wanderers among the nations. Doesn't say he's going to get done with them completely. He says, I'm just going to put them out there in a dispersed fashion. They're going to be wanderers. And that's what they've been for so many, many hundreds of years until 1948. They're back. But nevertheless, as a people, as a nation, there they were, cast off. And in their judgments, God got a witness and got his glory. because God says, I can't countenance the way they're going, so I'm going to judge them, but they're going to still be. Okay. Now, a lot of Christians go through this on a more personal level. A lot of Christians, they find themselves cast to the left or to the right or aside in some way. They find themselves, as Paul said, a castaway. Paul says, I fear lest I also be a castaway. Doesn't mean being lost. It means he's been put on the shelf. That he can't be used of God anymore. And the Bible says that some people are, in Matthew 18, turned over to tormentors. Think about that. He says, if you don't forgive your brother their trespass, you know, it's like this parable he gives. He says, it would be like that king who took somebody who didn't forgive and put him in jail, delivered him to the tormentors. You know, people pine. People are scorched. People wither as Christians. In fact, I tell you one thing to consider and maybe put it in some slot in your mind here. Put it in there. People who can be happy in sin are a problem for us. I mean, everybody sins, but if they can be happy in their sin, that's a problem. You see, God quickens the spirit. God quickens us. You he hath quickened. He hath made you alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins. And the Bible says when he quickens us, he gives us a heart of flesh. And when he does that, it doesn't change. He doesn't take it back. What he does is he chastens. In fact, he's going to use that word here in a minute. He chastens. But what they've done is they've lost their witness, so God casts them away, and in their judgment, he will get a witness. And what we see is that these people were cast away much like people in the day-to-day as Christians sometimes find themselves cast aside in some way. And the Bible talks about if the salt has lost its savor, it's good for nothing but to be cast forth and trampled underfoot of men. And sometimes when Christians get run over, that's a testimony. Do you know one of the prominent messages that Jeremiah gave the people of Judah in Jerusalem? He said, when the Babylonians came, he says, listen, what you need to do is you need to open the gates and you need to let the Babylonians come in and you need to bow down on your knees and you need to say, God is doing this. That was his message. And so what did they do to him? They took Jeremiah and they threw him in a cistern, which was probably a sewage pit. We don't hear that. And so the king comes to him, pulls him up, says, "What was there any word from God?" Like, yeah, I'm really happy to talk to you, king. Come on up here. You know, I'll tell you a few words. Okay? Pulls him up. He says, "Is there any word?" He says, "Yes, you need to open the gates and you need to let the Babylonians in because you are under the judgment of God." You see, even when they walk on top of the Israelites back then, when they walked on top of them, God wanted them to be giving a witness. Think in terms of Daniel and the three Hebrew brethren that were with him, giving a witness in that terrible, terrible place of captivity. You see, in their judgments, they would be wanderers in verse 17. And everywhere they went, they would be emblematic of God. Think of Jonah. He, as it were, swallowed in the great fish. Perhaps the juices breaking down some of the pigmentation of the darker-skinned Middle Eastern man vomited up on the land, and he became a sign. He himself was a sign to the people of Nineveh. Man, what happened to him? He was swallowed in a fish. I saw him vomited out on the shore. He came in here preaching, God's going to judge us, and subsequently, the people of Nineveh repented. He became a sign. In what? In his judgment. And my point is that they lost their witness, but God still would gain a witness, even if it came through their judgment. Verse 1 of chapter 10 says, Israel is an empty vine. Now that's a worthless vine, by the way. You remember when Jesus cursed the fig tree? You see, God would have figs. God would have fruit. He says that they are an empty vine. There's nothing here. They're not giving me anything. Why was that? Well, it was because they, thirdly, lost their wisdom. You see, they lost their wisdom. He says, Israel, verse 1 of chapter 10, brings forth fruit unto himself. Ah. Now, we need to think about that. This, the Bible is a mirror, right? The Bible says, he that hears the word and doesn't do it, he's like a man who beholds himself in a mirror and walks away forgetting what manner of man he is. And the concept of this word here, it convicts me. Do I bring forth fruit unto myself, or do I bring forth fruit for God? is the way that I define life and understand life wisely, locked into what God wants. He created man in His image to bring glory to Him. He called us out of darkness into the kingdom of light to show forth the praises of Him. There's verse after verse. He says, as my Father sent me, so send I you. You shall be witnesses unto me. Follow me. I will make you fishers of men. The whole concept of our defining of our lives. Do we simply bring forth fruit unto ourselves? There's nothing wrong. God says, tenth is mine. Now, I'm just talking about tithing. But He says, there's 90% you get to enjoy. So there's supposed to be some fruit to you. God wants you to be fruitful, right? But the true definition of your life should have the end game view of laying up treasures in heaven, of seeking those things which are above where Christ is, of bringing glory to God. He says they are an empty vine. They are an empty vine. And He says they bring forth fruit unto themselves. He hath increased His alders according to the goodness of His land. They have made goodly images, verse 1. He says it's been such a fruitful place they've lived in. And they've just kept, you know, building, you know, brick to brick, saying, well, look what we got, look what we got, look what we got. And it's all about me, and I'm all about me. He says, you can't be all about you. You have to be about God. And then you'll get to enjoy. The Bible says, I am come that you might have life and might have it more abundantly. So life is there. You will find yourself pining and scorched and fruitless if you're not doing this properly. They lost their wisdom because they began to start laying stuff up unto themselves, having fruit unto themselves. They gloried in the fact that they had this good land. Verse 2 says, their heart is divided. Put in the margin there, James 1. The Bible says that if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not. But a double-minded man is unstable in all of his way. So understand, the lack of wisdom has to do with having this double-mindedness. He says, their heart is divided. So they lack wisdom. They've lost their worship. They've lost their witness. And they've lost their wisdom. They're bringing forth fruit unto themselves rather than unto God. It says, now shall they be found faulty, verse 2. Verse 3 says, now they shall say, we have no king. Now this is a good thing, by the way, in one sense. It's the gift in the garbage. Because the problem they were having was they got him a king, and then they began to all prop up self and do their own thing and forget about God. Because, hey, after all, if the king was good, okay, we can all toe the line. We can all do good because the king's good. And we all have to be good today. If the king was evil, woohoo, it's party time. The king is saying, let's go to do bad things. Let's erect idols. Let's do more groves. Let's do this, that, and the other. I would remind us here today, just to give you a little heads up, because most of us don't read it often, and it's the concept of in the books of the Kings, the Bible talks about defining kings oftentimes as he did that which was right, or he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, right? And many times the things he said when he said he did that which was right, many times it would say, and put away the Sodomites from the land. I heard a guy talking yesterday on the radio about the guy who they're putting, that President-elect Trump will be putting over the military, the Pentagon or whatever. I don't know how all that works. But the guy said he will not countenance the whole transgender nonsense. The military is not a petri dish for social engineering. Because what's happened in our country is we've thought, you know, well, the king that is evil in the sight of the Lord is going to promote this nonsense. Let's bring in somebody who's got a little bit of clarity and says, you know what? If I were a guy, I'm not going to want to be in a foxhole with somebody. I don't even know if it's a guy or a girl, first of all. And if I know it's a guy who's dressed up like a girl, I don't even know what to do with that. I got to shoot somebody over here. But we can't be so confused. We subject our younger generation to nonsense. And then they spiral out of control because they have no way to define life at all. No way. Why? Because they've lost their wisdom. They lost their wisdom. Their heart's divided. He says, for now they shall say, we have no king. This is after judgment. They're going to say that because they're going to be carried away into captivity by the Assyrians. This is the northern kingdom again. He says, they have spoken words, swearing falsely and making a covenant. They were part of the covenant that God had made with them. Now, there was Mount Ebal and Gerizim. It's like the cursings and the blessings. He says, if we do these things, our part is, if we do these, we'll be blessed. If we don't do these, we'll be cursed. He says, it doesn't mean we're going to be gone completely or annihilated, but we're going to be wanderers. We're going to be miserable. We're going to be unhappy. He says, listen, he says, because judgment, verse 4, springeth up as hemlock. Now, we all know hemlock is associated with a poison, right? We've heard of it used as a poison to assassinate people, putting it in people's foods. It was said of Socrates that he prepared a concoction of hemlock to kill himself when he was under the sentence of death. He thought, I'll do it. I'll take care of it. I'm under the sentence of death and by my society, so I will drink this hemlock. Well, it is also sort of a sedating kind of thing. It makes people tired and sleepy and weak. He says they're under hemlock. He says their judgment springeth up as hemlock in the furrows of the field. Now keep your eye on that word furrows. He's going to talk about that again in a minute. It says, the inhabitants of Samaria shall fear because of the calves of Beth-Aven in verse 5. Oh, technically there is no Beth-Aven. Beth-Aven is a mockery name for the city of Beth-El. Beth-El was where Jacob made his... He made a stone for a pillow, and God ascended, and the angels were ascending and descending. He said, surely he's got it here. He called it Bethel. But this is where Jeroboam would come along later and set up a golden calf. So he says, we can't call it the house of God anymore. It's Beth-Aven. It is not the place of God anymore. In fact, Aven is going to be mentioned in verse 8, and Aven is the place where Aaron made the first golden calf. So that's why it's called Beth-Aven, because it's reminding them of that's where that's at. Now, see, I'm digging in deeper because these words are foreign to us. But when I do it, doesn't it thrill your soul? I mean, that this is what God... He's saying this is Beth-Aven, not Beth-El. This is where the golden calf showed up. And this is where it's been placed in state, okay, so that people can come to it. He says, these places are an offense to me. These people have lost their wisdom. It says in verse 6, Israel shall be ashamed of his own counsel. Israel's heart is divided. What was the division? It was between God's way and their own way. He says, he has brought forth fruit unto himself in verse 1. His heart is divided in verse 2. It says, he will be ashamed of his own counsel in verse 6. Verse 8 says, the high places also of Aven, the sin of Israel, shall be destroyed. And that's talking again, as I said, this is Aaron's first calf. But the high places of Aven, of what Aaron had put into circulation, it's going to be destroyed. Verse 10 says, it is in my desire that I should chastise them. Again, I go back to verse 17 of 9, where it says, he will cast them away, but they shall be wanderers. They're not going to be annihilated. They're not going to be brought into oblivion like, say, the Amalekites were under the curse to be wiped off the face of the earth. No, these guys are going to be, and they're going to be wanderers. And they're going to be an emblem of God's judgment, even though he has a plan for them as set forth in Romans 9 and 11. And the Bible says it is in his desire, it is his desire to chastise them. You know what that means? It's another picture of his abundant loving kindness and mercy. The Bible says, if you be without chastening, you are illegitimate children. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens, right? So this is that. He says, it is in my heart to chasten them, to chastise them. And what he's going to do is he's going to bring forth other countries. It says, and the people, verse 10, shall gather themselves against them. The people will be the Assyrians. They will gather themselves against them when they shall bind themselves in their two furrows. See, that word furrows showed up again. The furrows were, the northernmost region of Dan where they set up a golden calf, and the southernmost border of the northern kingdom, which was at Bethel, two golden calves. That was their furrow. They bound themselves inside the furrow. Okay, you know what a furrow is on a... You take an oxen and you're running furrows. You got these two mountains of dirt as it's pulling out someplace to plant. He says, they're going to dig into their furrows and I'm going to have to deal with them in judgment by bringing the people. Verse 11 says, and Ephraim is as a heifer that is taught. And that means that it is accustomed to this. It loves to tread out the corn. Now, this is an interesting verse because it's talking again about prosperity. They love to get their money and get some more money and get some more money. It is an amazing thing how that can really get us ramped up at a fever pitch. Boy, I can go get another thing, another thing. We had a gal come to our home, and she was literally shaking. And she was probably only around 50 years old. Shaking, nervous wreck. And she didn't know what was going on. She said, "Can I talk to you?" "Yeah, you come over and speak with me and my wife. We'll come and sit down with you." She began to unfold her story. She was working like 80 hours a week, and her husband was too. They rarely saw each other. But they had everything the heart could desire. They had those motorhomes that they drive around in. They had the boats, and they had the cars, and they had the big house, and they had one in Florida. But the fact was, is they were so overwhelmed at get, that they, if any one of them got sick or if any one of them couldn't work, that it would all fall apart. And that's what's happened in many cases to people. They get themselves ramped up into a position where they're really a nervous get to the point where they lose the plot. They worship the gift rather than the giver. And here they've lost their wisdom. And it says the people will gather against them because they bind themselves in their two furrows. Their wisdom has been lost. Verse 11 says, "I will make Ephraim to ride, and Judah shall plow, and Jacob shall break his clods." Now this means that "I will make him to ride," meaning Ephraim, the northern kingdom, is going to be gone. It's going to be taken away. They're going to ride like a chariot, like in a chariot, all the way to Assyria. They're going to ride. And then it says, "Judah shall plow." So they're going to get another 115 years. 720, northern kingdom falls. 605, Judah will fall, but they're going to plow for a little while longer. And it says, "And Jacob shall break up his clods." Now here's the hope in the midst of this, because there is a danger in the midst of prosperity. But there's an answer, okay? And the answer is, sow to yourselves in righteousness, verse 12. Reap in mercy. You see, we realize that we're all sinners. We realize that our propensity is to do wrong. So it's real nice, isn't it? When the clouds part, about 3 days this past week, it was all miserable, right? It's low, low key, everything's miserable, it's all overcast and dark all day long. It was like nighttime halfway through the day. It made you feel, ugh. But there was one day I'm driving along and this big break in the clouds came out of nowhere. Everything brightened right up. Aren't you glad when things brighten up? This is the bright spot. Sow righteousness. Do some righteousness. Do some good stuff. Not good stuff to get credit. Good stuff to bring glory to God. Good things that reflect well upon your Father who is in heaven. Good things that reflect well on Christ in this world. He says, reap in mercy. Break up the fallow ground. You know what that is. That's that real parched ground. You got to go in there and beat that down. It's hard. You got to break up the fallow ground. That's an intentionality you have to have if you're finding yourself a little hardened and lacking in wisdom. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord. Would I not say, after this election we just had, isn't it time to seek the Lord? Isn't it time that we just seek Him and say, you know what? God, I haven't had devotions. You know, we talk about the New Year's resolution. Rain on that. Man, we need to have an election resolution. Man, what am I going to do now? Am I going back to business as usual? Am I going to go so to myself? Am I going to continue to be all about me and mine and not worrying about God and His? You see, it's all about timing. And He says, now is the time to seek the Lord till He come and rain righteousness upon you. What would that look like? His righteousness raining on us. Well, I have to believe that it has something to do with the momentum that comes. You sow righteousness and He'll rain righteousness. You see, what happens is when you're out in the way doing something good for God, He gets involved in that and you begin to feel like this is where the good ground is. You know, there's a point where you're maybe doing some hiking at one point or another. Finally, you hit that level ground and it's like, okay, this is better. This is better. I like this much better than that. Boy, don't you? We're always trying to go against God when we're not sowing righteousness, because God would have us sow righteousness. And then He would rain righteousness upon us. He says in verse 13, "You have plowed wickedness." The word plowed makes us remember the words not easy. The way of the transgressor is hard. You just can't go on and do the nasty and the bad and the evil without feeling the effects of it and the wearing of it. He says, "You have eaten the fruit of lies. You've reaped iniquity." In verse 13, Because you didst trust in thy way. There it is again. Your way, your counsel, you're going to be ashamed of. Your way. He says, you did walk in your way in the multitude of thy mighty men. In other words, people showed you what it looked like and you did the same. Sort of like the UK is doing their evil. And America says, we want to be like them. Verse 14 says, therefore shall a tumult arise. Shalman shall spoil Beth Arbel. And that's just talking about Shalmaneser, who was the king of Assyria. He's going to come and he's going to plunder this place. Verse 15 says, so shall Bethel do unto you because of your great wickedness. In other words, that golden calf religion you've been facing, he says, that's going to bring judgment upon you if you keep living in that neighborhood, which is an adjustment of the nature of God and the truth of God and the reality of God. If we do live in an idolatrous spirit, it will bring upon us some sort of a judgment if we are truly his children, especially. It says, in a morning, in verse 15, in a morning shall the king of Israel utterly be cut off. Remember? They shall have no king. When Jesus came, there was no king in Israel, right? Because after the two judgments of Assyria and of Babylon in 605, they never really regained a sense of a king in their midst. And King Jesus shows up. And they kept saying, whose son is he? Who is he? They knew. They had all the records down, as it were, in the temple. They knew who was who. They knew he was a descendant of David. They knew he was a descendant all the way through back to the throne. He was the guy. They knew that. If they knew where he was going to be born, you can bet they knew who he was. But they said, we have no king but Caesar. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. They will have no king in one moment, in one morning. And if you underline the words in a morning, you'll see there's a hope there. It's not in a night, it's in a morning. And, you know, the Bible says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning, the psalmist says. And this is a morning when he begins to take what he hated. He said, they asked a king at Gilgal, and I hated them. He says, but they're going to have no king now. And they will not have a king again until King Jesus comes back, breaking the sky, as in Revelation chapter 19. And he will smite the nations with the sword of his mouth, and he will set up his throne upon the hills of Zion in Israel and in Jerusalem. And King David will be resurrected, and all of the saints of yore will be resurrected, and the saints of the church age will be there, and it's going to be a good day. But the king will come in a morning, because this is just the beginning. I'm going to fix it, God said. Now listen, there's a danger in prosperity. There's a danger that we might lose our sense of need for worship. We might lose our witness because we're so carried away by it. And we might lose our wisdom. Let's not let that happen to us. Let's not be like that. They are really an example for us of what not to do. Somebody said there are a couple of people in the world. There are the people who don't learn from their mistakes. There's the people who learn from their mistakes. And then there are people who learn from the mistakes of others. Let's be the wise at the end who learned from the mistakes of others. Let's sow righteousness. Let's do that according to that verse. What a good verse to end on. Sow to yourselves righteousness. Reap in mercy. Break up the fallow ground of your own hearts, if you will. For it is the time to seek the Lord till he rain righteousness upon you and me. Let's take that to our hearts, shall we? Let's bow together.